Now, the power of the great outdoors. Reporter Kavitha Cardoza from our partners at Education Week looks at a program to expose students to our national parks. It's part of our weekly series, Making the Grade.
Nice big circle. Come on in.
Fourth graders from Pennycook Elementary School will soon see something they've never seen before.
So welcome to the Redwood Forest, everyone.
Even though they live in Oakland, just 45 minutes away, most have never been to a national park. You might call it a sensory experience.
Aaron, can you tell us what's another way we can observe nature?
Like with our nose?
With our noses! You're okay.
Ranger Araceli Montero leads the tour. The children approach the first stand of redwoods.
We are now inside of the magical forest of Muir Woods.
Oh my God.
Everyone, take a good look up.
Whoa.
We are now standing under one of the tallest living thing in the world.
In this classroom, students use all their senses.
This one feels thick.
It feels really thick, doesn't it?
It smells like salt. Yes.
What? Look up there. What? Those are clustered ladybugs.
It's like a whole country of them.
Teacher Darlene Wong says that place-based learning, having children learn by experiencing subjects rather than simply reading about them, teaches skills like critical thinking.
Show me your evidence. What evidence do you have to prove what you're saying or what you're writing here?
Oh, whoa, they're so big.
The National Park Service's educational programs serve approximately 7 million children every year. Rangers conduct teacher workshops, go on classroom visits, and perhaps most importantly, create curriculum for these trips based on state standards. This class is learning about California habitats.
Oh, look what I found.
Without these programs, Wong says she couldn't have brought her class to the forest.
In terms of testing and what we have to cover in terms of curriculum and time, it's really, it would be really hard to justify it.
Julia Washburn went from junior ranger to park ranger. Now she oversees all educational programs for the National Park Service.
It's one thing to read about a wetland, for example, in a textbook, and it's a very different thing to be standing up to your thighs in mud in a swamp or in a wetland such as Everglades. It just really makes the learning tangible and very relevant, so students can understand why they're learning something, not just what they're learning.
The source of the excitement? Long-legged bugs called water striders. What's not as easily seen are the challenges facing the Park Service.
Oh, you four, go ahead.
Budgets are down, there's 10% fewer staff than 5 years ago, and the next generation of park visitors is uncertain.
Using national parks as classrooms isn't just about learning. It's also about growing the next generation of park visitors.
If we don't engage young people of color right now with our parks, then 100 years from now, we are concerned that there won't be the celebration of the 200th anniversary of the National Park Service.
Grace Lee heads the National Parks Trust. They raise money for 20,000 kids to visit parks every year.
There have been studies that have done recently that have shown of the almost 300 million people that have gone to national parks in the last couple of years each year, that a very small percentage of them are young people, and even a smaller percentage of them are children of color.
See the USA in your Chevrolet.
50 years ago, the National Park Service partnered with AAA and Chevrolet to reach returning World War II veterans and their families. Creating the generation of park users we see today. Aging baby boomers remain the largest percentage of park visitors overall.
What we're feeling now is that there's a new generation that is more urban, more diverse. Maybe they are first generation immigrants to the United States, first generation citizens. Maybe they came from a country that did not have public lands or parks or a tradition of that. We are reaching the kids, and they're bringing their parents to the parks.
John Jarvis, the director of the National Park Service, says America's parks must tell the country's evolving story.
Filling in the gaps, as I would say, in the American narrative, we've added sites for civil rights like Harriet Tubman. We added Stonewall, which tells the story of the LGBT civil rights movement as well. We need to be telling that story so that all Americans feel part of the patriotic and symbolic values that this nation embodies.
What am I holding in my hand?
Jarvis says they've also embraced technology, webcams, online chats, even video games.
National park sites are actually Pokemon Go sites.
They are. The Pokemon Go community has spread these little monsters all over the National Park Service, and we are embracing that because it's getting people outside and getting using technology in a way that sort of connects them to these places.
Here in the Redwood Forest, these 10-year-olds have found something far better than Pokemon Go characters.
The evidence shows that when kids are exposed to the place, they learn, they retain, they become more interested and more excited about learning.
Whoa. How do you feel right now?
Being in the Redwood Forest makes me feel happy.
Being in the Redwood Forest makes me want to meditate.
Being in the Redwood Forest makes me feel short.
The director of the Park Service hopes that using parks as classrooms is just the beginning.
What I wanted to do was to say that the National Park Service is a contributor to American education, both for students, but for lifelong learning as well.
For the PBS NewsHour and Education Week, I'm Kavitha Cardoza reporting from the Golden Gate National Recreation Area in California.